My name is Catharine Stimpson, and I have had the privilege this week of being in the Villa Pietra and of meeting some of you, and I am very glad of it. It's now my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Elizabeth Wood, but first I will say a few words about her, and then she will talk, then we'll have a Q&A, and then I promise you there will be a reception out there. I don't see any students, so perhaps we can even sneak in an alcoholic drink or two, but I cannot promise that occasion. Ellen Toscana was to give this introduction, and because of unexpected press of duties here, she's unable to do so, so I am acting in her stead. Elizabeth Wood, born Elizabeth Cranwell in Sydney, Australia, and grew up in Adelaide. She's an independent scholar who has resided in New York since the late 1970s. She's become a central figure in international and Australian musicology, and one of the founding voices in the new musicology. And she has contributed pioneering work on women's music, Ethel Smyth, the composer, feminist theory, and queer, lesbian, and gay studies. I must say about Ethel Smyth, she's being produced more and more often, so your chances of hearing this extraordinary English composer will be increasing. Elizabeth Wood studied at the University of Adelaide, graduating with honors in English literature, honors in musicology, and a PhD in musicology in 1979, which was a groundbreaking study of Australian opera, the first of its kind. She was awarded a Fulbright Scholarship in 1975 to study at the Graduate Center at the City University of New York. She took up that scholarship in 1977, and the following year, and I hope my American chauvinism will not show, in the following year, she immigrated to New York with her four children, where they resided to this day. Even I know that that's not Vernon Lee. That is Ethel Smyth. But Elizabeth Wood will be discussing the relationship between these two extraordinary figures. And on behalf of the Villa La Pietra, thank you so much for coming. And on behalf of Elizabeth Wood, thank you for the lecture you're about to give us.
Thank you, Kate. I hadn't seen the error, but Vernon Lee and Ethel Smyth might have been rather cross about a misnaming. They were pretty fierce about, I need to bring this down, thank you. Is that all right? The first thing I need to say is if my Australian accent gets in the way of your understanding, put up a hand and I'll try and sound easier. And also, if I go too fast, please put your hand up. And I wanted to thank Ellen, who's not here, for this wonderful opportunity to come to Florence to meet students, faculty, and the people of Florence who are interested in Vernon Lee and Ethel Smyth. And thank you to Ellen's joyous and super helpful professional staff. But particularly, I also want to thank for their hospitality and kindness to me, Giuliano Angeli and the Angeli family, Federica Paretti and Stefano Vincieri, custodians of Il Palmarino, which was Vernon Lee's home, and creators of the Cultural Association of Il Palmarino, who are carrying on the traditions of Vernon Lee's salon and mentoring of young artists in Florence. And also Star Brewster, who is here, custodian and inheritor of his family archive, a unique resource for scholars like myself. He has just given copies to me of Ethel Smyth's letters concerning Vernon Lee, and I can't wait to transcribe them. Thank you. Thank you all. So I'm not a Vernon Lee scholar. My interest in Vernon Lee stems initially from her friendship with Smyth and with other mutual friends, but I have become increasingly interested in Lee, especially from a musical perspective. Where Lee was a longtime resident of Florence, Smyth was a recurring short-term visitor, a little like an NYU student who finds later ways and reasons to return to this city. So I've been thinking about the experience students have of visiting a foreign country. An astute American literary critic, Elizabeth Hardwick, thought, I can't see you in the front. Can I just move? No, that's fine. Are you fine with the view? Elizabeth Hardwick thought that visitors abroad, being non-citizens, as exiles from home, confront the new in a gambler emigrant frame of mind, that is, in a confused mood of hope and panic. In confronting the new, writes Hardwick, the transplant, whether for a short or a long time, is not a blank page or a blotting paper. She or he has experienced an elsewhere. He or she has learning and experience of life. In contact between the known and the new, in that mood of hope and confusion, the transplant in a voluntary group convened in and by art and learning discovers the self, or creates a self. Hardwick was writing about Mrs. Trollope in America, but she might have meant the NYU student in Florence. What students bring to this place, what students take away, what effect Florence itself may have in your lives, your futures, is your story. Here are the stories of two young English rebels who lived here 150 years ago before you. Vernon Lee, 1856 to 1935, is the name Violet Paget gave herself in the expectation that Vernon was more likely than Violet to be taken seriously as a writer and intellectual in a man's world. She grew up in Italy with her English mother and invalid brother, settled in Florence in 1873 when she was 17, and was a fixture for 60 years at Il Palmerino, her villa near Fiesole, until her death in 1935. Ethel Smyth, and that's Ethel Smyth, 1858 to 1944, was 2 years younger than Lee. She had left home at a large family in England at the age of 19 to go to Leipzig, alone and unchaperoned, which was rebellious and unheard of, to study music composition. Smyth first visited Florence in 1882 when she was 24, and again thereafter in 1884 to 5 and so forth. She rented a room on Via dei Serali, overlooking tile roofs to the Boboli Garden and Porta Romana. I believe this is still the bohemian quarter of the city. Both Lee and Smyth travelled constantly in Britain and Europe to promote their work, practice their art, and encounter the new, but they did not actually meet until 1893 as guests across a dinner table at Windsor Castle, where they learned they were both in love with the same woman, Lady Mary Ponsonby, their host, a companion to Queen Victoria, but I run ahead. I ask you to imagine you are following Ariadne's slender thread through the maze of memory and musical narrative. Here first is Vernon Lee. Could we have the other picture, please? Yes. Sorry, not this one, but the, thank you. Right. Okay. Here first is Vernon Lee, author of some 46 books, including novels, ghost stories, a play to which I will return, collections of fantastic tales and fairy tales, travel writing, essays on genius, I think it's genius loci, the spirit of place, and contributions to a burgeoning aesthetics movement in the late 19th century, inquiring into the nature of art, beauty, and taste. Lee's admirers with similar interests who became good friends include Walter Pater, whom she met through Oscar Wilde, and William and Henry James. A contemporary expatriate in Florence at that time, the German-born sculptor Adolf Hildebrand, who will reappear in this story, wrote about the aesthetics of what he called pure architectural form. The book was The Problem of Form in Painting and Sculpture of 1893, while Lee's chief interest lay in aesthetic empathy, the study informed by scientific facts and the methods of psychology and biology, namely observation, experimentation, analysis, interpretation, of the interrelations between a work of art and the mind, and equally, in Lee's opinion, the body that enjoys and understands it. For decades in the galleries and museums of Florence, Lee could be heard and found noting, measuring, and assessing emotional and visceral responses she observed in her assistant and beloved companion, who in turn attempted to tell Lee what she felt while viewing a painting or listening to a musical work. Lee's last published work on this line was Music and Its Lovers, an empirical study of emotional and imaginative responses to music. That was the subtitle of 1932, that codified and analyzed written answers to various questionnaires, which Lee and another beloved companion had devised and exchanged with invited listeners to recitals of classical music. A curious 20-year project that attracted some supporters, including a man, Edmund Gurney, who was the founder of the Aesthetics of Hearing and author of The Power of Sound. I was thinking that nowadays Lee might seek responses via Amazon.com or a happy or not terminal. But if today her method of aesthetic inquiry seems simplistic and outmoded, it opened new paths of inquiry at the time by drawing attention to theories of reception and sensation rather than exclusively focusing on the work of art itself. Lee also recognized the uncanny, the existence of unconscious responses to art that may deeply affect our appreciation of it. Harder to find now are Vernon Lee's earlier studies dating from the 1880s, when only Pater and Simons were exploring the antique, the medieval, and the Renaissance in Italian art and music. There are many volumes of Vernon Lee's on these subjects. Particularly interesting to me, however, are her ideas about genius loci, notes on places, and the sensations that place evokes, where she developed, ideas that she developed on morning drives, I'm quoting, in all the lanes and mountain roads of Florence and farther afield. She writes memorably, rapturously, and musically of the magical colour and quality of light, I'm quoting here in various sources, the incomparable buoyancy and radiance of a Tuscan summer, of that queer smell heavy with romance of wine vats, decaying plaster and woodwork, of bells singing in the summer sky, and wintry days of mist among olive groves, the luminous bluish smoke of the hills, where cypresses rose black and tapering, and I know, she adds, I know with a little stab of joy that this is Italy. She hears poetry in the Tuscan Apennines, in how the mountains are always doing something, very often to us. They are never without movement in their splendid topographical drama. Yet we're able to live familiar with them, unlike the High Alps. Their small scale is companionable all year round to people they've made their own. The medieval serfs, the peasants, the mill workers, people who live there. Then at Villa Lemmy, she imagines how Botticelli may have watched a similar sunset as he left his work in a little quiet farm villa 400 years ago to saunter across the fields to the castellated Careggi, where Lorenzo the Magnificent supped and discussed Plato and improvised verses about falcon hunts, comic paladins, or antique nymphs, end of quote. Italy, Tuscany, Florence, a lifelong source and inspiration for Vernon Lee. But who was she? What did John Singer Sargent see when he drew and painted her? Sargent, born in Florence, had been her childhood companion and was her lifelong friend. Small, slight. We need the other. How do I get this other Vernon Lee one? What do I push? There is another one. Sorry, Lucas. I didn't watch you properly before. There's another one of her.
But it's similar, to this
no,
one.
No, not that one. It's the drawing. Okay. Oh, maybe it's not here. Okay.
I've put
that's fine.
Dream. These two,
it's fine.
The same. These two links brings to the same, this picture.
We'll
so
go back to this. Do I
okay.
just touch it?
Okay.
Perfect. I still don't know how
no.
you did that. Sorry about this.
Wait.
No. I'm so glad I have Lucas
no,
here.
No, no. This computer doesn't work
well,
really.
Well, that's nice. That stops me in my tracks. Is the sound loud enough?
Yes.
And the accent is okay?
Oh.
Ah, thank you so much. Right, what does he see? It was, in fact, another one of her that I was referring to, but this will do. Small. Slight, a black dress with high Gladstone collar, the long sharp nose and protruding underlip, gleaming and darting grey-green eyes, behind huge 18th century goggles, irregular features, slender hands, soft blonde hair. She looks at once audacious, refined, argumentative and shy, notes the first woman she loved, Mary Robinson Duclos. Sargent caught the look of a new woman of the 1890s, an unwelcome sight for people still attached to Victorian conventions of proper female roles and behaviour, unwelcome because the new woman was creating and defining herself. Lee was always considered controversial. She was called opinionated, caustic, arrogant, aggressively argumentative, labels flung at independently minded and rebellious women to this day. Henry James thought hers the most able mind in Florence, but dangerous and uncanny. Yet women such as Mary Robinson and Mary Ponsonby were dazzled by Vernon's improvisations. It was agreed by her friends like Ethel Smyth that Vernon Lee could dominate conversations and tyrannize companions, yet could never show or receive affection. Sexually reticent, she recoiled from even a hug, a kiss, a touch. Her affairs never lasted. When one woman after another, exhausted from trying, gave up and left, Lee admitted to feeling, quote, naked, vulnerable, lonely, and fell into periods of depression. I have an absurd fear of my own emotion, said the expert on other people's. Was self-assurance and dogmatism a mask, a bluff? Ethel Smyth, whom we saw earlier, was Lee's opposite. Sargent, who was very musical, drew Smyth in charcoal in 1911 at the keyboard, singing a stirring song by the Irish composer Augusta Holmes, whom Smyth had met in Paris. Sargent was thrilled both by Smyth's musicality and her legendary fearless athleticism. On her way to Florence in 1882, she'd actually stopped off to climb a mountain in the Swiss Alps. She hunted, played tennis and cricket, and the new game of golf. Sargent's drawing captures, I think, that energy and eagerness, what Harry Brewster called Ethel's hungry greyhound quality and zest for life, personification of the vim, vigor, gaiety, and go that Thomas Beecham, the conductor, heard in the music she wrote. Note too, with the previous picture of Ethel Smyth, the costume, open jacket. Lucas, you're wonderful.
Yes.
There she is. Note the new woman costume, open jacket, white shirt with collar and tie, hair in a loose bun, held down by a tam o' shanter. It's a vision of freedom. Within a year of Sargent's drawing, the new woman had become a militant feminist. Smyth joined Emmeline Pankhurst, leader of the WSP, of the women's suffrage movement in Britain. Mrs. Pankhurst's statue and historic statue commands to this day a small garden behind the Houses of Parliament in Westminster. You may visit this one day and pause to honour an earlier time of women-led resistance to political and sexual oppression. Note that 2018 marks the centenary of women gaining the right to vote and to stand for Parliament in the UK. Smyth helped organise street protests, author petitions, especially among women musicians in England, and house brave feminist prisoners on hunger strike. These were the women temporarily released from prison before they could embarrass the government by dying. She herself was arrested for smashing the colonial minister's windows with a champion athlete's well-aimed stone and sentenced to a sobering term at Holloway Prison. She pinned the highly desirable medal awarded released prisoners, a brooch engraved with prison bars, on her purple, green, and white tie when conducting orchestras and choruses of women. Conducting, of course, was another job historically denied women until quite recently. She especially liked to perform with her suffrage choruses, her March of the Women, and also other music she wrote for the movement. But again, I want to return to Florence with our thread in 1882. The first person the young Smyth, the student Smyth, visited were resident expatriates of a growing European and Anglo-American subculture here of educated, artistic cosmopolitans that by the 1900s made up 1/6 of this city's population. As a yardstick, in 1880, the total population of Florence was roughly 169,000, compare with London and Berlin, 1 million each, or Manhattan, 1.165 million. Today, the population of the metropolitan area of Florence is over 1.5 million. These may be debatable totals, but they give a kind of comparison. First, Smyth met the internationally renowned sculptor I mentioned before, Adolf Hildebrand, who had purchased and renovated San Francesco di Paolo near the Porta Romana, a one-time medieval monastery and farm, for his studio and family home with Irene, his wife, and their quintet of little blonde daughters. I believe there was a little blonde son too. Smyth next visited number 22, Via De Bardi, in the Lungano Torrigiano apartments, home to Harry Brewster, a Paris-born Anglo-American man of wealth and leisure, descended from Elder William Brewster of the Mayflower. Also living there was Brewster's German wife, Julia, and their two little children. Julia's sister was Elizabeth Liesel von Herzogenberg, with whom Ethel was passionately in love at the time. Stay with me on this thread, I'm not going to linger there for long. Liesel, a wonderful pianist, interpreter, and friend of Brahms, was married to Heinrich, Ethel's tutor in fugue and counterpoint at Leipzig. Time commands me to condense these stories and Ethel's central role in them into a paragraph. It's an impossibility, but I shall try. Smyth was immediately attracted to Hildebrand's serene, gay temperament, brilliant mind, apparent sexual sophistication and magnetic, possibly amoral, she wondered, personality. I'm quoting from her correspondence at the time with the principals involved and from her later memoirs. She was soon a constant visitor to San Francesco. They discussed his theories of proportion and hers of counterpoint. Hildebrand made a plaster cast of her, and when she learned he was a good sight reader, violinist and violist, she composed her first string trios and quartets, one named for him, to try out together. Harry Brewster was encouraged to break out his cello and join them. HB, as he was called, was aged 32 in 1882, 8 years older than Smyth. Her first impression of him was of a dreamer, yet an acute observer, a shy, well-brought-up child, and strikingly good-looking. Hildebrand's bust of HB from the 1870s depicts, I think, a romantically beautiful aesthete. HB, in his own words, was a philosopher and intellectual, a spectator, not an actor in life. My field is purely speculative, he said. His wife Julia's mother, a baroness, was Harry's godmother. He had married Julia in 1873, the same year Vernon Lee moved to Florence. After 10 years of rarefied, reclusive togetherness, H.B. and Julia had fashioned a marriage of intimate tenderness, but without passion, power, or permanency, unquote. A partnership always open to negotiation and a questioning dialogue on subjects of mutual interest, such as the nature of metaphysical existence, atheism, and friendships. By agreement, it was an open marriage. If either one should fall for another, they agreed to end it. Now, these are Smyth's memoirs, so it's her point of view. Their construction of exquisite defences had kept society at bay, but by 1882 had grown claustrophobic and inertial. Something was missing, they agreed. That is, until Ethel Smyth knocked on their door. She claimed she was not especially interested in H.B. Unknown to her, however, he had confessed to Julia that he thought he was falling in love with Ethel. So off he went to Algiers, ostensibly to hunt lions, but perhaps in search of a cure. Julia rationed Ethel's visits. Irene Hildebrand ended them. Irene had been made so angry and jealous of the bantering flirtation going on downstairs between sculptor and sitter that she armed the children with sticks and stones and led them downstairs to smash Ethel's bust to pieces. Ethel had become persona non grata, but didn't understand why. No one enlightened her. Baffled, she went home to Surrey for the summer to copy the instrumental parts to the quartets and vocal chorales she'd composed in Florence and to practice the pipe organ. She returned to Florence in 1884, and by then Harry had also returned and now declared his intention to leave Julia and pursue Ethel. She seems to have been flattered, but emotionally and sexually confused, unsure what to do. Then the defences broke. Irene, it turned out, had informed Liesel von Herzogenburg and the Baroness, and by default, the scandal spread through the tight little house music circles of Leipzig, where Ethel had been such an astonishing prodigy, that Ethel was a mischief maker whose Cherubino-like insinuation in the cracks between couples had destroyed Julia Brewster's marriage. Liesel immediately ended her intense 7-year affair with Ethel without a word of regret or explanation, accusing her horse-riding lover of being an egotistical young colt riding roughshod over all. Liesel forbade further contact between them. Ethel rejected HB's unwanted affection and forbade further contact between them. Florence was by now, for Smyth, a site of emotional devastation and moral panic, even physical fear after being chased by a stranger along the river when she feared for her life. Understandably, she had a nervous breakdown. She believed the loss of Liesel and her reputation in Leipzig threatened her career there and determined she must turn instead to England and begin again. I don't mean that to sound like a moral fable for the NYU student in Florence, but that is how things stood when Smyth met Vernon Lee at Lady Ponsonby's dinner party. And there began the creative aftermath to the crisis that was Florence. For if Florence was the first and chief resource in Vernon Lee's creative life, Florence, the birthplace of opera, presented Ethel Smyth with enough theatrical material for a lifetime. In addition, salvaged from her youthful experience in Florence, she found a source of personal and creative inspiration in enduring friendship and artistic collaboration with both Harry Brewster and Vernon Lee. Smyth went on to write 6 operas, 3 with Harry as librettist, H.B. as librettist. Lee was so impressed by their first collaboration in the opera Fantasio, based on a comedy of Musset, that she dedicated her own new play, Ariadne in Mantua, to Smyth, quote, thanking and begging her for music, unquote. Smyth promoted Lee's play to London directors, urging its production, but never wrote music for it. Instead, she and H.B. derived the scenario for their third opera, The Wreckers, her most successful, from Lee's novel, Penelope Brandling. the tale of a group of Cornish wreckers and religious fanatics who lit false beacons to lure ships on the rocky shore and plunder them. The rebel wrecker was called Thurza, who, with her illicit lover Mark, lights warning signals, an act that wrecks the community and its livelihood. The lovers are condemned to die by drowning in a sea-engulfed cave. HB died in 1908, a week after attending a concert performance, a London premiere, of the first two acts of The Wreckers. Smyth was at his side, together with his adult children, Clotilde and Christopher. Then in 1914, at the onset of the First World War, the long battle for women's rights turned to patriotic war work. Smyth trained as a radiologist and served at a French military hospital in Vichy. On leave and undergoing treatment for recurring problems with her ears, she wrote to thank Lee for her latest book. Their political views were strongly opposed. Lee braved and battled public shaming for having joined a pacifist union and for writing political tracts condemning the war, but their friendship endured. The war broke Smyth's remaining links with Germany and German music. She circulated a new plan for an English national opera that would train singers in English and promote the work of English composers and directors. Meanwhile, she composed words and music for three more operas, one with a suffrage theme, another a military comedy, the third, Fête Galante, a dance drama of fickleness and deception based on a fantasy play by Maurice Baring, a writer, diplomat, expatriate, and mutual friend of Vernon Lee, who also shared Lee's interest in ghost stories. I think he spent most of his Italian life, his life in Italy, in Rome, but of course he often came to Florence. Fête Galante is the work that most expresses Smyth's experience of Italian music. A formal Renaissance garden by moonlight, a garden very like this one at La Pietra, is the elegant setting for a group of commedia dell'arte puppets who perform a parallel play within a play for the members of the court who have disguised their identities in masks and cloaks. The music included Baroque style dances, and it's among her most beautiful music. Smyth wrote it in 1924, many years after Lee wrote Ariadne in Mantua. Shortly before Lee died in 1935, the play of Ariadne that she had dedicated to Ethel Smyth was especially staged by her friends in Florence, who formed the chorus and audience along with professional actors and musicians on harpsichord, theorbo, viols, portable organ. Period furniture, costumes, and textiles were on loan from a well-known antiquarian. The music Lee chose was by Palestrina Monteverdi and Guido Caccini's beautiful Amarilli Mia Bella, which I think we'll hear at the end. That had been composed in 1601 at Florence, a madrigal Lee had first discovered in a songbook belonging to her first great love, Mary Robinson. A touching tribute, of course, by the people of Florence. It was like the city's farewell to Vernon Lee. She was too deaf to hear it. Smyth also became quite completely deaf towards the end of her life. For Lee, the play, A Romance in Five Acts, is a personal allegory and very self-revealing. Diego, stroke Magdalene, having known passion but never allowed to express it, yet capable of arousing passion in another, with the power of art, the singing voice, a woman's voice that breaks the silence and gives sound to those who cannot sing. Because Ariadne in Mantua, birthplace of Virgil, Vernon Lee fuses the myth of the love of Ariadne, daughter of Minos, for Theseus, with the legend of a courtesan, Magdalene, for the young Duke Ferdinand Gonzaga of Mantua. In life, the Duke had married secretly Camilla Farr de Bruno, but they divorced the same year, 1616, and their son was not made the Duke's heir. Gonzaga, also in life, had received famous singers, women and castrati, and musicians at his court in Mantua. Monteverdi arrived there in 1589 in his 20s. His opera Orfeo premiered at Mantua, and in 1608 his opera On the Myth of Ariadne was performed for the marriage of Francesco Gonzaga and Margherita of Savoy. A week of celebration ensued. I think there was something like 4,000 people in Mantua at the court at the time. Only Arianna's celebrated lament has survived. This, I think, will be my next research project, inspired by my visit to La Pietra and Florence, because I want to draw parallels between Vernon Lee's Ariadne, Shakespeare's Twelfth Night, also of 1601 or 1602, and Hofmannsthal and Richard Strauss's opera, Ariadne auf Naxos, of 1910 and revised for 1915. Because in common, they each have the woman dressed as a man or boy whose voice soothes the troubled breast of a sad, reclusive nobleman and draws him back into society and happiness. If music be the food of love, play on. It's Valentine's Day on Wednesday, isn't it? Lee's cross-dressed Magdalene Diego, Strauss's cross-dressed composer, Smyth's Pierrot are figures from Florentine opera and Commedia dell'arte traditions, precursors of the neoclassical period in Western European music in the 1910s and 20s, with composers such as Stravinsky, Dafaya, Prokofiev, Schoenberg, many others, with ballets and operas that explore gender ambiguity, sexual intrigue, deception, dissemblance, and mistaken identities. I want to turn now, more or less in conclusion, to Vernon Lee on Genius Loci, the spirit of place that is Florence to her, which is haunting, spectral with ghosts of the past and music in the air. Vernon Lee writes, quote, "We still feel the ghostly, though none of us believes in ghosts as logical possibilities, more as imaginative probabilities, the imaginative power that they possess, the ghost which slowly rises up in our mind, the haunter not of corridors and staircases, but of our own fancies, a vague feeling we can scarcely describe." To the student, Lee now turns. "Be the artist yourself," she says. "Let us see and hear this ghost. Let it become visible and audible to others. Paint us that vagueness. Mold into shape that darkness. Modulate into chords that silence. Tell us the character and history of those vague beings," end of quote. And what do we obtain, Lee asks, quote, "A picture, a piece of music, a ballet, a story, but the ghost is gone." Or is it gone? Here at La Pietra are ghosts, I have discovered. The fabric ghosts of a New York artist, Patricia Cronin, which are hanging in the Acton collection downstairs, where Cronin says these gauzy panels confront representations of women in the collection, give presence to their absence, their hidden and lost histories, women who dared to define their own lives. I think Vernon Lee also, in a mild way, haunts La Pietra. I went looking for her in the collection, and I found one small book, her anthology of earlier essays, which came out in 1929, at the end of a 2-foot row of Berenson's books. Most of you know that Vernon Lee and Bernard Berenson had a kind of 20-year silence between them because Berenson accused her of borrowing from him. And in fact, she was possibly earlier than he in some of her theories, but it was a mutual disliking. I think they resolved this at the end. But that's one sample from her 46 books. There above and around her are full shelves of Compton Mackenzie, Evelyn Waugh, Harold Acton himself, prolific writers of that generation. But she is elsewhere in Florence, at the British Institute, for example. Her library is there, and her annotated reference books are there in the archive. Ethel Smyth, of course, is, to my mind, haunting San Francisco, but of course, Star Brewster may have a different idea. I felt her there because her letters are there, with her lover and first librettist, H.B., and among other people. And the music, she's also in Vernon Lee's dedication of Ariadne, so I just feel the slight whiff of Ethel Smyth in Florence. What I want to do before we have comments or questions is to listen to Guido Caccini's madrigal that first inspired Vernon Lee and her Ariadne. It's called Amarilli Mia Bella, and it is sung by Cecilia Bartoli, of course. Could we listen to that and then have any comments or questions? Could we listen to the, do I have to touch anything? It's set up for, I have no idea where we are. Where's Luca's? Then we need Luca back. While we're waiting for Luca, I'm stopping there because I had quite a lot of notes on Ariadne, but I can see that all of us are actually thinking that we need to see this play performed. And I will just add that we are getting more opportunities. It's all right, Luca, just hold on. More opportunities to hear Ethel Smyth. These women have been neglected, but they're coming back. And if any of you are in New York on May the 11th this year, come by Carnegie Hall, where a very large chorus, the Cecilia Singers and orchestra, conducted by my friend Mark Shapiro, are performing The Prison as a New York premiere. Okay. Yes, thank you. This is now Amaryllis by Guido Caccini, father of Francesca Caccini. that beautiful song. Thank you so much for coming. We can go on listening.
can switch off?
Yes, I can. Thank you so much. And you can switch everything off if you like.
You want to handle your questions?
I'd love it if you did.
Yes. May I ask you something about the records? I believe it could be defined a verismo opera because I mean, it's a low-class subject, people in a village, real life. It's real, I believe. Is there any connection that you may know of between Ethel Smyth and our veristi composers like Mascagni or Leoncavallo, since she spent time in Florence, in Rome, I think, also. Was there any...
Well, the real opera verismo... Sorry, can you hear that? Verismo opera, realist opera, was certainly at that time, or earlier, in the air, and she certainly knew them. What I think she was interested in this story was not only the novel, but also she travelled down to Cornwall. She was interested in the stories of local people and noted them. So yes, she was looking for this realism, but she set it in the earlier part of the 19th century. Who was the great, was it Newman? It was at a time of huge religious upset in England, where the Cornish people felt separate from England, and she presents them much more than Vernon Lee does, as fanatics. So it's very much about intolerance, fanaticism, and ill-wrought gains. Exactly. By the way, there's a wonderful painting by Turner called The Wreckers, but that's not set in Cornwall, it's further up the coast. But I think it was, Cornwall was filled with these stories, and the people expressed their own separation from Britain. So it's a kind of revenge thing going on, like many of the verismo operas. I don't know if that answers your question. Thank you. Any more questions? Had you ever heard of Ethel Smyth before? Or Vernon Lee, yes, I'm asking you. Yes, you had. Yes.
Thank you very much. I was wondering if there are any recordings of Ethel Smyth's music, something that we could listen to, something else that we could listen to.
Yes, I didn't bring any with me, I'm sorry. Yes, when I started work on her, there was one recording, 15 minutes max, of Sir Thomas Beecham conducting the overture to The Wreckers. That was all that there was. When I started, her manuscripts were in the British Library, originals, covered in changes and little blinds you picked up, and underneath was a change of key or something. A mess, because her work wasn't really published at that point. It was hard to find. A lot had been lost in the war. Since then, bit by bit, she's not only been published, but recorded. And you can now find online wonderful recent performances of her chamber music, the piano trio, the piano sonatas, the songs that she wrote in Leipzig, which are wonderful leader. The sort of thing that she was up against, women composers of her time were up against. And she took the scores of the songs to a publisher in Leipzig who said, oh, you know, women don't write music. They'd already published Josephine Lang and a couple of other women, but there was no memory, there was no collective memory that women could actually compose. They each had to reinvent the wheel. But now, yes, you can hear a lot, and it's online, and you can, I think the whole British Library collection is now digitized. And she's being performed. I mean, in America, she's being performed. Leon Botstein's The Wreckers was a wonderful performance. hasn't come out in a recording, but you can get the records conducted by Odeline de la Martinez at the Proms. Odeline has also conducted and recorded The Bosun's Mate, and they're now doing in England the Fête Galante. So she's back. Thank you. Any other? Sorry.
Am I making this up, or did she and do I need a mic? Am I making this up? And I probably am. But did she and Vernon Lee quarrel about Fête Galante? Did they collaborate on Fête Galante? Was Vernon Lee aware of what Smyth was doing with Fête Galante? I mean, in terms of their friendship, was Fête Galante a part of it?
That I do not know, because I've not found any correspondence between them. Mind you, I have to go up to Colby College and see if there's anything there, but what I do know from the letters that Star Brewster has just handed me is that Vernon Lee did hear Fantasio, and she certainly knew about the Wreckers, but there is absolutely no reference anywhere to the Wreckers being based on Vernon Lee's novel. And I wonder whether Vernon Lee, in her modest way, because she was extraordinarily modest and shy, said, look, don't acknowledge me. And Ethel then, in the memoirs, writes fulsomely about the Cornish fables. It's also interesting to me, by the way, that Thirza is the name of the singer heroine of George Gissing's novel Thirza, by the name. So there's no reference in Smyth's memoirs or letters to this date that I know of about the sources of the Wreckers. In terms of Fête Galante, both Vernon Lee and Ethel knew Maurice Baring very well, so I'm absolutely sure Vernon Lee knew about Fête Galante. How much she could hear in 1924, I don't know. Whether her hearing, was it going by then?
Not yet.
So I would love that correspondence. I've always been baffled why there's so little surviving correspondence between Vernon Lee and Ethel Smyth. It could have been destroyed by the biographer of Smyth or by Lee's wish to have her private life kept private. I just don't know, but I'm sure she knew it. Yeah. Any other comments or questions? Thank you all so much, and I think we
thank you, Liz. Thank you so much. As you can see, this is an extraordinary authority on Ethel Smyth, becoming, with the help of people in this room, an even better authority on Vernon Lee. And now, the evening is not over, and on behalf of Ellen Toscana, may I invite you to the reception, Luca? And thank you, Luca, for all you've done to help with both the technology and the food. So, ladies and gentlemen, please, for more conversation and a reception, may I invite you on behalf of Ellen Toscana to the next room.